Posh.
Good morning, Leah.
Hello, thanks for joining me.
It's a pleasure.
I was doing a bit of research before our interview and looking at all the things that I might want to talk to you about. And you've done loads of really amazing things, loads of really cool adventures, and you're about to go off on a new one with Dave Cornthwaite, which I'm sure you're really excited about.
Yeah.
But I was like, right, I'm sure she's been asked about this a zillion times already, and you're doing loads of interviews. And actually, there's one question that keeps coming up at the moment through my readers, and also it's still a massive question mark in my own life at the moment. And that is around money. And
right, okay.
So I figured that, given that you're this person who's living a completely alternative lifestyle in comparison to the majority of people out there, you might be a good person to talk about that with. So I'm sorry if that's putting you a little bit on the spot, but we'll just dive in and see where we can go with it. All right?
No, that's fine. I mean, a lot of people ask me, well, you know, how on earth do you afford to do it? Mm-hmm. So basically, when I started, when I first started climbing mountains, the first mountain I climbed in 2004 was Aconcagua, and it wasn't that expensive. It was kind of like the expense that you'd spend on a very nice summer holiday, I suppose. And I got the money from my savings. And I was working at the time. I was doing special event repping, that kind of thing. So in that sense, when I first started, I was just like anyone else. I kind of had a job and I paid for it out of my savings. Mm. But then when I wanted to get into it more seriously and wanted to figure out ways to do it, I actually didn't have the money and I didn't have the kit that I needed. So you just have to be a bit creative about it. But also, you have to be prepared to make certain sacrifices. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a lot of my friends were getting good jobs and getting houses and cars and all that kind of thing. And that really didn't happen for me because I had to find a way to live for nothing, basically. So I had to, one of the best ways to do that is to eliminate all your bills. And not everyone's as lucky as I am. But most people can generally find a parent or a grandparent they can stay with relatively inexpensively. You know, you might have to contribute a little bit of board money, but apart from that, it's nowhere near like having a mortgage or bills. So basically, I lived at home, and that's how I eliminated having to earn a big wage.
Yeah.
And then with the kit side of things, I just started working with sponsors, and you know that as well didn't just happen overnight. I started off by wearing the kit and loving the kit that I wanted to use, and I did stuff in that kit, and I got some exposure. So I kind of went to them saying, "Look, I've already done this. This is what I can do. Would you be prepared to work with me?" And with sponsorship, you know, you have to kind of be prepared to get lots of no's. And then there's sort of three levels of it. And there's the sponsorship where you buy the kit at trade. There's the sponsorship where they give it you for free. And then the kind of third and ultimate level is you get paid to wear their stuff. Now, realistically, you know, I'm not a celebrity. I wasn't winning gold medals at the Olympics.
You are a celebrity.
So my first aim was to get it at trade, but my goal was to kind of get the kit for free. So initially I got stuff at trade, and then I did more and more with that. And I worked hard to get exposure for them with the trips I was doing. And then eventually, you know, with my sponsors now, I generally get things for nothing. So that's how I was able to get my kit. And with the climbing, the way that I was able to keep doing that was I started working with the company I was climbing with. And that meant that sometimes I'd get a discount. Occasionally I'd get it for free, and very occasionally I'd be paid to go on the trip, depending on what kind of trip it was. Mm-hmm. And I think the thing that you have to do is be really prepared to sacrifice money and things, you know, in order to afford the things that you want to do.
Yeah.
And there's definitely a balance to be had there. And I just decided there were these things that I wanted to do, certainly in my 20s, and I was happy living like that. But I will just say that when I reached 30, I did start wanting things. You know, I wanted my own space. I do want the sports car. You know, I want nice things. I like nice things. It's not the be all and end all. And so I've had to kind of accept that maybe I will have to work a little bit differently. Mm-hmm. But the great thing for me is because of what I did in my 20s, I now have this great platform which allows me to do the work that I want to do,
yeah,
and the work that gets paid for, which ultimately is the speaking and the presenting.
Right, okay. And just to go back a little bit, what would you, do you have a job title? Like, what would you say that your job title is right now?
I say that I'm an adventurer, mountaineer, presenter and speaker.
Okay.
Yes.
And have you ever had in your life a long-term, what most people would call a normal or a conventional job? Or did you just kind of fall into this from the beginning? Have you ever had like a long stint of sort of like 9 to 5 or anything like that?
Not really. I mean, at 18, I went out and did a ski season in the French Alps. So I was in a chalet. And then after that, I went travelling, so I had different kinds of work just to keep me going while I was travelling. Mm-hmm. So that wasn't 9 to 5 at all. And then I did more work out in the Alps. And then I started working with my dad, actually. We started importing from China. So I spent a lot of time over there. And, you know, in a way, that wasn't like 9 to 5 because I was working for myself. Mm-hmm. And with my dad, so, you know, you just work all hours, whenever, all the time. And I realised that actually that wasn't what I wanted to be doing. And so I was doing special events work. So I was managing certain events, being involved in them, and that was allowing me the freedom and flexibility to do the other things I was doing, although it wasn't paying very well. And then randomly, I did a short stint in Dubai, which was a 9 to 5. I was working as an account manager for a design company, but that was only for 3 months. It wasn't my cup of tea at all. Yeah. And although I was earning much more money than I had done with other jobs, just wasn't for me. It didn't allow me to do the things I wanted to do. And what was crazy was I was spending this money I was earning, so ultimately ending up not really even better off, you know. And I was just, yeah, I had to get out of there.
I know that feeling. And do you think having never really had that sort of been in that 9 to 5 lifestyle, that's just given you a very different perspective on the ways that you can live your life and the possibilities around earning money? Because I think a lot of people, you know, their experience is just to fall into this 9 to 5. And so they've got this one view of life and how money is earned. But do you think you've been lucky in that respect that, you know, you've had a different experience?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, my dad was he started out as a market trader. So he used to say to me, I always want you to be able to, you know, you can always go and sell something because then you'll always be okay. And there was a time when I was importing leather belts from China, and I'd go out to the market, so 4 o'clock starts or whatever, and I'd sell these leather belts. And it was an amazing lesson for me because I just thought, wow, I can always do this. I can always buy something and sell it. You know, I can always rely on me to earn some money. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was never... Yeah. It was never about having to rely on a 9 to 5. So I guess I've had a lot of entrepreneurial type of people around me.
Yeah.
And I've always worked for myself. So my natural kind of default is to do it that way rather than go down the 9 to 5 route. But I don't think the 9 to 5 route is necessarily a bad one. I have a lot of friends that do that, and it absolutely suits them, and I can see that works. And sometimes I look at them and I think, wow, you know, you've got these things, you've got this life, you've got this routine, which I think is a great thing. So I just think it's about being really honest about what you want and where you're at with things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you said, so currently now in your life, you earn your money from speaking and from what else did you say?
Presenting. So
okay.
I've started doing a little bit of presenting, and some of the sponsors that I work with, they don't necessarily pay me to wear or use their kit, but what can happen is I can present and do adverts for them. I can help with research and development, that kind of thing. So there's an area where I can do work for them that I get paid for. So that's working really well.
Okay. And when you got into this life that you're in, you're adventuring and mountaineering and everything, was money even in your mind then? Or was your entire focus just, I love doing this, I'm going to do it, and the money just came afterwards?
Yeah, I'm waiting for the money to come afterwards. Yeah, I suppose it was definitely about this is what I want to do. I've got to find a way to do it. And there was never a big thing in my head that was like, I've got to buy a house or I've got to save this amount of money. I guess I just assumed that one day I'd earn money. Do you know what I mean? You just do, don't you? When you're younger, you think, yeah, one day I'll do this and that. It'll just happen.
Yeah.
So I kind of was focusing on what I wanted to do. And it's probably only been in the last 12, 18 months that I've thought, actually, I do need to earn X amount of money because there's certain things that I now want to do. So At the time, probably not so much in my early 20s.
Right.
But one thing I will say is, with a lot of the jobs I've done, you can very often get a job that doesn't necessarily pay money, but will put you in the place that you want to be. And I think you just have to have the courage to take that first step and be without the money to know what's there and what options there might be, because I do believe that you'll just figure out a way.
Yeah.
You know, if it's on your mind and you want to do it, you'll figure out a way. And actually, the most important thing is a shelter. It doesn't have to be a nice home. Mm-hmm. You know, you just need a shelter, food and a community. And once you've got that sorted, it depends how far back you're prepared to strip it. I think another thing is, people have certain things and then they're scared of losing it, which is why they don't take the risk and get off. And in a way, I never had that. I never had the house or the mortgage or the car. So I never had anything to lose. I was just very, you know, I was travelling light. I was just seeing what was out there.
Yeah. It's a really interesting thing to think about, actually, because I found that when I left my job, I had quite a big chunk of savings and I was desperate to hold on to it and I was scared of losing that. And then I gradually got comfortable with a little bit less and I was like, okay, that's okay. And then more of it went. And actually now that I have very little left, I feel it's quite freeing, actually. I mean, obviously, like you say, you need the basics, you need food and shelter and water. But if you've got that, you don't need that a lot more than that, actually.
Well, you don't need any more than that. We just want more than that.
Yeah.
And it is interesting because I've got quite a few friends who have, you know, they're far more extreme than me in kind of their things, material things. They've got rid of everything and they've literally just, you know, they have their room where they live and they have a couple of bags or whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because absolutely all of them come back with the same kind of conclusion, which is they're much happier and freer. Mm-hmm. And so I think there's really something in that, but I also think it is lovely to have things, so I don't kind of want to, exclude, if you like, people that do have the opposite opinion, because I think that's equally valuable, but I just think it's nice to know that you don't have to be fearful of having nothing, because often all this stuff actually just inhibits you and causes stress.
Yeah, and where do you think that fear comes from? Because it's so true that, you know, we're sort of in this world where we're striving always to earn more and to have more, and we feel like we need more all the time. And where do you think that comes from? Do you think is it the media? Is it society that, like, people everywhere are telling us we need all of this stuff? I mean,
I think it's a combination. I mean, a lot of the things that we have kind of been built into as a result of routine and habit. So, for example, we have 3 meals a day. Why do we do that? Well, because we always did that, and that's what your parents feed you when you're little. And if you look at any other animal, they don't have set meal times unless we enforce it on them. They eat when they're hungry.
I just imagine some animals, like, sitting down for dinner. That's really funny.
But it's kind of true. And, you know, when I've been on mountains and things, it becomes about eating when you're hungry, not when it's a set meal time. And it's only happened to me a few times, but I found it really interesting. And I think it's the same with our values about what we have and money and all that kind of thing. And also because we're used to it, you know, we're used to having a certain level of comfort. So it's like anything, when you remove that, there's a fear attached to it. So I think that fear comes from the unknown.
Yeah.
And being scared of not having something.
Sure. Do you have a philosophy in your life about money and the role that it plays and the role that you want it to play in your life?
I suppose I'm so used to just sticking with my knicker philosophy.
Oh yeah, come on, tell us about that.
If your knickers are right, your day goes right. And it kind of doesn't really, I don't really have a philosophy on money. I think there are different times I feel differently about it. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes I'm totally carefree and I don't need any money and everything's fine. And then there are other times when I'm quite frustrated by the fact that I haven't got money to do the things that I perhaps want to do or get things that I've feel like I need. And, you know, especially when I compare my friends who are my own age who have now got houses, cars, all that kind of thing, and I've just been doing all this other stuff. So it feels different at different times. I think it's sad when money, it becomes a huge stress and a problem in your life and is something that that kind of fixates you or rules you. I think it's nice to have freedom within it. You know, when I was younger, actually, I always wanted a sports car, and I kind of thought, well, I'll pass my test when I'm 17, and by the time I'm 19, I'll definitely have a sports car. Anyway, I've still not got the sports car. And it's interesting how the further along I get, the less important it is to me. Because, you know, if I had the money right now for a sports car, I wouldn't go and buy a sports car because there's so many other things I'd want to do with it ahead of that. So your values change as well.
Yeah, sure. Actually, that's a good lead on to my next question, which was going to be, if you won £1 million tomorrow, what would you do with it?
Oh, so many things. I think there's a lot of times I'm with my friends and we're laughing about something, and I would say something along the lines of, if I was a millionaire, I'd just spend an absolute fortune on this just because it's silly and ridiculous. But because of all the charity work I've done and all the different places that I've seen where people genuinely don't have enough money for what they need, let alone what they want, I think I would be inclined to go down that route with it. I'd want to do some good with it. Yeah. I kind of like that whole Secret Santa thing. Like, if I want a lot of money, there's certain friends I'd love to just pay their mortgage off and not even tell them, just do it. You know, but the whole charity thing, it'd have to go into something good. And I think if you split it up, there's, you know, there'd be money there for fun, there'd be money there for charity, there'd be money for friends.
Yeah.
I think you could do a lot with it. It's interesting, isn't it? I always think, you know, when people say, oh, I don't care about money, yeah, money doesn't bother me, I don't need it. If you said to them, would you like £1 million? I bet they'd say yes.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you can't deny it. I mean, we need it, don't we? And everybody wants it. But and then just finally to wrap up, let's take it back to the adventure thing, and still, you know, I guess around the charity and money thing, but you're about to go off on another adventure with Dave. Just tell us a little bit about that and get us excited about that.
I met Dave through a mutual friend, and he said, I think you two would get on, you should meet up. So we met up and we started talking about Dave's Expedition 1000, which is 25 journeys of 1,000 miles or more that he's doing on non-motorised transport. And he's done some amazing things. He's skateboarded across Australia. He's just got back from a 1,000-mile swim in America. So some incredible stuff. And I jokingly said to him, Dave, we should do a journey together. And he said, yeah, let's think of something. And just before Christmas, he sent me an email with a picture of an Elliptigo, which is it's a cross trainer with wheels on it.
Right.
It's like running in air. It's an amazing contraption. It looks like a bike with no seat, but it's actually more like running than it is like cycling. And he said, do you fancy doing 1,000 miles on one of these? So I just wrote back and said yes, and then we actually started talking about it, and it evolved from there. And now in 12 days time, we're about to set off on this 3,000-mile journey, not 1,000 miles,
okay.
A 3,000-mile
challenge
journey, across Europe. Yeah, so we'll be sharing our passion for adventure as we go. Dave's got one of his taglines, is say yes more, and it's a fantastic philosophy. I love it. And
is.
Obviously I do that as well.
Yeah, it is.
And so we'll be encouraging lots of people to say yes more, but also raising money for Copperfield, which is a breast cancer charity.
Well, I hope it goes well. Thank you very much for answering my questions about money today, and I hope that it's been useful for everyone out there. It's been great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Insurance, where do your loyalties lie? Is that your alibi? I don't think so. You don't care. You do it for the money. Say it's there. You sue it for the money.